As we go through this, if you have a question, please ask. I have no script. The photos is what I'm going to talk about. And I welcome your questions as we go through it. This will be a chapter in my next book, which will be about trains, planes, and automobiles and the weather. And much of what I'm showing in here will be in that book probably sometime in 2006, next year, I think. This is all based on pictures that are in the book. And why the glacier? Well, it was right here. New Harmony was covered by glacier several times through the last million years, and I don't know how to talk about that, but this is the way the snout, the glacier, would look. These are some of the animals that were in North America, except for the rhinoceros. Did you know the camel was a North American animal? And of course, you have the elephants and the lions and such. They all died after the last glacier 10, 12, 14,000 years ago. These large animals died out. They were extinct. Science does not know why. There's a theory that the glacier returned quickly, like almost overnight. Also around America, you'll find if they know where to dig, they dig so deep to go back to a certain date, and there's a layer of black soot. And the other theory is, and probably the one that will prove to be likely, is meteors exploded over Canada, and all of them flared out, and they just burned everything up. And that's what that black comes from. But we don't know until I guess they do more research on that. Have you seen this sign before? We looked very, very... This was a sign at Solitude, right at the Big Creek. There was another sign at Blairsville that said exactly the same thing. And what this is showing, here's the state of Indiana, and here was a toll of the glacier right here. Now, it may be low, and, you know, how does it look? Nobody knows. But this was what it was, and these were all taken down. It's believed that the highway department put these out, and it kind of followed the toe of the glacier. Every county, every major road, they would put one of these signs up. And I went to the highway departments, the garages and everything, and nobody knew, none of the people that worked there 4 or 5 years ago when I was doing the research knew anything about it. But Becky Higgins, who was on at Mount Vernon, a woman showed this to her, and she sent it to me, and here you've got it. So that's a great sign. Sir?
There's a family of Moses that live in Wadesville. And when those boys were in high school, they were responsible for getting one of those signs put back up.
When was this? Looking to put up a sign that's like that.
Heavens, I don't know.
I don't know what was wrong with it.
80s, but it wasn't marked, and I don't know who they got a hold of, but it was just west of Big Creek as you begin to go up the hill there. And it's not there anymore.
The highway department, the museums, nobody knows what happened to the signs, but they used to be there. And I suspect there were several dozen or score around southern Indiana that followed this trail. And this right, now this, the way this has it, Mount Vernon was not in the glacier. New Harmony was. Griffin was. But that glacier would move back. Nobody knows. There was nobody living. But the glacier would move back and forth over thousands of years, creep eons and creep back. But when they begin to melt, I'll tell you more about that as we get right up through here. This is Mumford Hill. And this is, I'm going to show you this map again for Griffin, the tornado. But here was Mumford Hill. If you look at the contours, the top, you know what I'm talking about, all of you do? Mumford Hill is about 110 feet above the ground around here. That's how much the erosion from the melting glaciers did. It left, if you go up the stream, up towards Vincennes, you'll find three more hills just like this. And apparently they were heavy with rock, and they didn't erode the way all of this ground did around here. That was not proven science, I don't guess, but that's the way it looks. The Wabash River dominated the Ohio. All of the ice was to the north, and as that would melt and come to the south through the Wabash River, it's believed, and as you come from Carmi, when you used to come to the bridge, There's one hill you can see about 12, 14 miles, and that was the Wabash River. And it was 200 some odd feet deep. Of course, this was you know, a giant. It would dominate the Ohio. Today, the Ohio dominates all of the trade water, the Wabash, the Green, and all of that. However high the Ohio is, that's a starting point for the Wabash and the Green River and all of that. But back in the day of 10,000 years ago, the Wabash was dominant. It governed the Ohio. Strange, huh? I'm going to jump now to 1350 to 1850, the Little Ice Age. And nobody knows why this happened, because it lasted, as you can see, 500 years. I would suggest to you it probably lasted another 100 years till about 1950. I'll tell you just a little bit about it. I can't say that, but there's some evidence that it was still going on after 1850. This changed the world. 60% of all humans died over those 500 years. And animals, big, small. This was the bubonic plagues. The plague came in and just wiped out Europe. And this was all driven by the Little Ice Age. George Washington crossed the Delaware, and notice it has ice in the river. That was right before Christmas. The Delaware doesn't freeze up till January, but it did in the Little Ice Age, because this was a function, the French Revolution and the American Revolution were a function of the cold weather, and the English wanted more food, and they were dominating the American colonies and everything. So we went to war over the Little Ice Age, you might say. The Irish potato famine, which just, people were happy to get grass and roots to eat. The potato famine, you know, was Irish's mainstay, and all of a sudden, the people just starved. It was a horrible time to live, and that was the Little Ice Age. But in 1816 was maybe the worst summer in North American history. You know, I'm not talking about 500 years ago, I'm talking about recently. A lot of people moved in 18. The Lincolns came to Indiana. John Pitcher, if you know John Pitcher, the lawyer, famous lawyer from Mount Vernon, left Connecticut and came to the West. I like the Lincoln story, and there was a lot of people did. What happened that year was Indonesia, Mount Tambora exploded, and it could happen next week. And it put so much ash in the sky that it chilled down the whole climate over the northern hemisphere. This man right here was Reuben Witten, and he's in Connecticut in 1816. He raised 40 bushels of wheat and saved his neighbor's lives by growing wheat when nobody else could. Here's a fact that was really so difficult. In 1816, right here in Evansville, Indianapolis, ice or snow every summer month in that year. How do you grow your wheat? How do you grow your corn? How do you grow your beans, potatoes? You really can't. A lot of people, the further to the east and to the north you went, the worse the weather was. But right here, it was horrible. And a lot of people just died from that. Of course, the Lincolns moving into Indiana that year, their first year here, I wonder how they survived, because they had to put out, you know, they had to till the ground from forest ground, but they did. Thomas was very good. I believe I've written a book on Thomas and Abraham, on the Lincoln family. Thomas, I think he's my hero. People think Thomas was mean and cruel. Abraham was a product of his father and his mother. And you know, Abraham was, if you live north of the Ohio River, you think Abraham was great. If you live south, well, not maybe. Here's everything I'm doing is timeline. We're going forward. In 1826, the New Harmony Ring Gauge, and many of you have seen that upstairs in the glass case. Here it was. This is a picture out on the lawn. It looks like that house is the one that's right across the street over there. So this ring gauge was probably out on the west part of the lawn. And here it is to date. The interesting thing was, there was an equal ring gauge. Don't know where they were made, but one was stationed in London, England. One was in Washington, D.C., and the third one, you know, was right here. And they did that so they could compare the rain, and, you know, I don't know what they were looking for, but they were scientists. You know, they were doing their research, and that's how you got the rain gauge that was put out on the lawn and is now upstairs. I wanted to find what this is made of. It looks, notice it's pitted, implies it's steel. If I had a little magnet and touch it, you could see if it was steel or for copper, what have you. So I don't know what it was really made from. By the way, this was John Chapel Smith had something to do with the rain gauge. And that was in 1826. And then in 1852, you have seen his booklet and looked at his good. This is John Chapel Smith. It's out there in the drawer. I've given several of these away. I gave one to the Louisville Free Library because they didn't know about this. The tornado that he talks about, it killed three people here, and that's in your microfilms from the New Harmony newspaper. And it went to Georgetown, Kentucky, where it killed 11 people, and Louisville newspaper didn't cover it. I was really disappointed. So I did send them a copy of this booklet just to say thank you. The Louisville Free Library is what that's called, and of course it's enormous. This is some of his sketch. Have you ever seen these? Have you ever put them on display? This is one of his sketch. Look how talented this man was. That's artwork. There are several pencil sketches he made. And what he did, he plotted the fall of the trees, which way they fell. And you got to think about this. He came to the conclusion for the Smithsonian Institute that a tornado is a rotating wind. My God. What did they think it was before that? I've wondered about that. Was it the finger? I'm serious. What did the people think? And, of course, nobody knew what John Chapel Smith said. But what were the people thinking a tornado was? Something from God? Pardon? It's an interesting thought what it was. But anyhow, John Chapel Smith did this work and sketched 7,000 or 9,000 trees, how they fell. You know, just like this. See how he fell? Showed the trees falling, and he could see that swirl, and that's pretty clever. Here's a tornado footprint. This is a road that appears to be about 40 feet, maybe the size of a big house, or that's how the tornado looked going across this field. In 1884, the Belmont disaster happened between Henderson and Evansville. They used to use a lot of rail cars. This was high technology. You know, a lot of this stuff you're seeing, we think of as crude. No, this was technology. High tech. The people would travel in this car. They never had to get out. They were in comfort. They'd pay their toll, get in at Henderson, and the engine would take them to Evansville. They'd get off another bunch and get in, go to Henderson, back and forth all day. I'm sure they did do that at night. But in 1884, a tornado hit them about midway between Henderson and Evansville, and it killed 14 people and, of course, sunk. I think they recovered probably the barge and put it back into service, but that was the Belmont disaster that hit Henderson and Evansville. I'm going to tell you about some floods. This was the 1884 flood, which was, I think, the third largest on the Ohio River. Clara Barton worked. She came to Evansville and worked with her boat. She had a boat dedicated for her, and she was going out on the Ohio's and I guess up the Wabash, because remember, whatever the Ohio was, the Wabash had to be higher, because you had water coming down from the northern, from Vincennes and Terre Haute and all of that, and it couldn't get out into the Ohio because the Ohio said, "Not me, baby. I'm blocking you." So the Wabash had the same floods as the Green River, and all of those did as it went forward. This is the water, WATTER, that's now Riverside Drive. Water Street makes a lot of sense. I don't know what was wrong with that name. Here's Main Street, hotels, 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 and you can see a boat is tied up here. See all of the barrels, and this happened here as well. All the cargo back in 100 years ago was shipped in barrels, wood barrels. And Hogshead, there's not a Hogshead was three times the size of a regular barrel.